Chapter 27. Return of the Grand Tutor. When Bi Gun strode through the palace gate in complete silence, Huang Feihu ordered General Zhou Ji and Huang Ming to follow him. Bi Gun set off at a fast gallop, the wind whistling in his ears. He had traveled about 5 li when he heard a woman hawker at the side of the road selling heartless cabbages. "The cabbage I'm selling has no heart in it, sir." "What if a man has no heart?" Bi Gun asked her. "A man with no heart will die at once," the hawker replied. Bi Gun uttered a loud cry and fell from his horse, blood pouring from his chest. The woman hawker was terrified and fled the scene immediately. Arriving moments later, Generals Huang Ming and Zhou Ji found Bi Gun lying dead under his horse, his robe stained with blood. They were puzzled, not knowing what had happened. Before his departure from Bi Gun's residence, Jiang Ziya had written a note, on which a charm was drawn and his seal was stamped. Once Bi Gun drank the ashes, his internal organs were protected from harm. Even when his heart had been removed, Bi Gun was still able to ride out of the north gate. Had the woman hawker replied? "A man can live even without a heart." Bi Gun could have continued on his way. It was the miraculous charm that allowed Bi Gun to pull his heart out, leave the palace, and ride out of the north gate without losing a drop of blood. Huang Ming and Zhou Ji returned to the palace and reported to Huang Feihu what had happened. All the other ministers were heartbroken. The tyrants unjustly killed his uncle, violating both the law and the ethics. "I'm going to see him right now," Xia Zhao, a junior minister, cried. He did not wait for the king's permission, but made his way straight onto the happy terrace, where King Zhou was waiting anxiously for the heart soup. Xia Zhao approached scowling. He did not kneel down or offer greetings. "Xia Zhao, why do you intrude without an order for admission?" King Zhou demanded. "I've come to kill you," Xia Zhao cried. King Zhou burst into laughter. "There's never been any provision in the rites for a minister to kill a king. You damned tyrant. You know clearly that there's no provision in the rites for a minister to kill a king, but is there any provision in the world for a nephew to kill his uncle without cause? Bi Gun's your uncle, the younger brother of your father. How could you have conspired with that enchantress Daji to have his heart taken out? As you killed your uncle, I will kill you now," Xia Zhao said. He grabbed the flying cloud sword that was hanging on the wall and rushed forward to stab King Zhou. The king was highly skilled in martial arts. He dodged to one side, and Xia Zhao's blow landed in midair. "Guards, seize him!" As the guards ran forward, Xia Zhao yelled, "Don't touch me! The tyrants killed his uncle, and it's only natural that I kill him." When the guards were almost on him, Xia Zhao bravely threw himself off the happy terrace, dying instantly. Hearing of the tragedy, the ministers were deeply grieved. They had helped bring back Bi Gun's corpse from beyond the north gate, and his relatives began to enact the funeral rites. As the funeral was in progress, news came that Grand Tutor Wen was returning to Jiaoga after a great victory. All the ministers immediately mounted and rode 10 li out of the capital to meet him. When they reached the camp gate, Grand Tutor Wen sent word that he would meet his colleagues at the palace gate. They hurried back to the palace gate. Grand Tutor Wen set out too on his pure black unicorn. At the north gate, he caught sight of the paper pennants of a funeral procession. "Whose funeral is this?" "It's for Bi Gun," they replied. Grand Tutor Wen was astonished. He entered the capital and saw the gorgeous happy terrace towering above the other buildings. His colleagues lined the roadside at the palace gate to meet him. He dismounted. "Venerable colleagues, I've been away for many years. I find everything's changed here in the capital," he said with a smile. "Grand Tutor, have you heard about the rebellions and the situation here when you were in the north?" Huang Feihu asked. "I was well informed from month to month and I read all the reports, but I was occupied on the front. Only by the grace of heaven and the fortune of His Majesty was I able to destroy the enemy. How I longed to have wings to fly back to the capital and discuss these matters with the king. Entering the grand hall, Grand Tutor Wen wondered at its bleak silence and the thick dust on the king's desk. He noticed the tall, yellow pillars standing on the east side of the hall. What are those big, yellow pillars for? Why are they standing in the royal court? He asked the guards. Grand Tutor, it's a new torture invented by His Majesty. They're burning pillars. What's a burning pillar? Grand Tutor Wen inquired further. Huang Feihu moved forward. Grand Tutor, the burning pillars made of brass with three fire channels. Any minister who dares to point out the faults committed by His Majesty is subjected to this torture. Charcoal and wood are used to heat the pillar red hot. Then the victims bound hand and foot to the pillar and burnt to ashes. This torture makes the loyal retire to hermitage and the good and talented resign their posts. Many have left the capital, and many have sacrificed their lives in vain. Grand Tutor Wen was greatly enraged. His three eyes flashed angrily, and the divine third eye in the middle of his forehead emitted a powerful white light. He ordered the royal guards. Strike the bells and ask His Majesty to ascend the throne at once. The officials were delighted. After drinking the soup made from Bi Gan's heart, Daji had completely recovered. She was dallying with King Zhou when an attendant came in. The bells are ringing at the Grand Hall to announce the victorious return of Grand Tutor Wen. He demands your presence. King Zhou was silent for a long time, then ordered, "Prepare the royal carriage. I'll go straightway." After greetings were over, he said, "Grand Tutor Wen, you went through a lot in the North Sea District. You've achieved victory, and your service to the state's truly meritorious." Grand Tutor Wen knelt on the ground and reported, "Thanks to your good fortune, I've been able to eliminate all the rebels in the North Sea District. I was always ready to sacrifice my body for the state to return the kindness shown me by the late king. However, when I was on the front, I heard that the palace was in chaos and the dukedoms beyond the capital had rebelled. I was deeply worried and longed to fly back. Now that I'm back, I'm eager to know all the facts." Both Jiang Huanchu and A Chengyu were sentenced to death, as Jiang conspired to slay me and was in a plot to rebel against the government. Moreover, their sons are treacherous and lawless. They've risen in rebellion and threaten our passes. King Zhou explained, "Who are the witnesses to prove that Jiang Huanchu conspired to seize the throne and A Chengyu plotted to rebel against the government?" Grand Tutor Wen inquired. King Zhou remained silent, unable to give an answer. The Grand Tutor went forward and snapped, "When I was fighting the rebels, you didn't reign with virtue. You devoted yourself to wine and women. You slaughtered the loyal. What are those yellow things standing there? The ministers insulted me with wicked lies. I was forced to deal with them with those burning pillars." The king murmured. The Grand Tutor asked further, "When I entered the city, I saw a lofty building. What is it?" "In the hot summer days, I suffered from the heat and had no cool place to rest, so I had to build it. Not only can I relax there, but I can also see into the distance and keep in touch with the outside world. I named it the Happy Terrace for this reason." Grand Tutor Wen was very upset. "Why is the state in disorder? Why are the numerous nobles in rebellion? You've failed in your duty towards them. You rule without benevolence and won't listen to them. You associate with the minions and keep away from the loyal. You indulge yourself in wine and women day and night. You make people suffer through large construction projects. You're the cause behind their rebellions. I remember clearly the reign of our late king. All the frontier tribes offered allegiance to us, foreign countries made obeisance, and people lived in peace and prosperity. But what have you done? I hope you'll give the situation deep thought. Since I've returned to the capital, I'll endeavor to set the country in order. I'll report to you later what I plan to do. Please return to your apartments for the time being, Your Majesty." The king had nothing to say in his own defense. All he could do was leave the court and return to his apartments. Grand Tutor Wen, however, remained in his position. Fellow colleagues, please don't return home yet. I would like you all to come to my residence, he said. They all followed him back to his home. Fellow colleagues, I've been away from the capital a long time. He addressed them when they were all seated in the Silver Peace Hall. That's made it impossible for me to pay any attention to state affairs. However, I was entrusted by the late king on his deathbed with the care of his successor. I cannot break my promise. I'm sorry to learn that he rules without law and virtue. I would like all of you to give me the truth so that I can find a way to deal with the situation. Grand Tutor Su Rong began. It's not convenient for all of us to speak at the same time. I venture to propose that Prince Huang Feihu tell you the whole story, from beginning to end. Then you may hear it without interruption. A good suggestion. Grand Tutor Wen agreed. General Huang, I'm listening with rapt attention. Please tell me everything. Huang Feihu bowed and related in detail all that had happened, from Daji's entry into the palace to the death of Bigun. At the end of his report, Grand Tutor Wen let out a roar of anger. It's all because I was away for so long. I've let down the late king and ruined the state through my negligence. You may all return home now.